Hunting in packs and able to kill with deadly precision, these wild dogs are much more aggressive than the dogs that you and I are used to.
They're called the African hunting dogs, definitely because they are the best hunters. They're never in a rush. They'll just chase you, you get tired, they catch you.
On this episode of Wildlife Warriors, join me as I meet Dedan Ngatia, a conservationist who has dedicated his life to saving this remarkable species. When most tourists visit Kenya, they come to see lions, elephants, leopards, and giraffes. But very few will make it to this remote part of the country to search for wild dogs. Wild dogs were once so common across Africa that they were shot as vermin because they killed livestock. But today, there are fewer than 7,000 across the continent. Finding them can be extremely hard. Thankfully, I've come to meet Dedan Ngatia, an expert on wild dogs. Dedan works at the Impala Research Center, a 20,000 hectare ranch in Laikipia. My friend Abu Okari, a famous blogger, accompanied me on this trip.
So this is the Wild Dogs Project, and I've been working on this project for over 2 years. And the interesting story about this is that the project was started after 20 years of wild dogs missing in Laikipia. And then a single pack reintroduced itself in Laikipia around 2000-2001. And that's when Professor Rosie Woodruff from the Zoological Society of London started this project with a big goal of trying to follow that population, single pack, awesome. And to bring the whole population back. Amazingly, over at that time, the project has followed over 30 to 40 packs and collared over 140 individuals.
One thing I realized pretty quickly is just how much Dedan loves his work with wild dogs and how personally invested he is in their survival.
Wild dogs are kind of a medium average weight animals, and how they survive is that they survive by being in packs, in large numbers, hunting in packs, making decisions in pack and deciding where to go and working as a team. That's how basically the wild dogs survive. Let me show you how we differentiate between dogs, how we do the IDs.
Sure.
So these two guys are puppies born the same day and by the same mom. Can you tell any difference between the two dogs?
This one does have more spots on the front legs.
That's a great start. So what we do, we use spots to differentiate between dogs. If you look closely, this guy has more spots on the front left leg, more than this guy, but we don't use all the spots. We use this specific spot. So the only way I can differentiate between these two individuals, born on the same day, same sex, and born by the same mom, is using this small, white, unique spot that this guy doesn't have. Other puppies might have all these spots, but the other puppies born on the same day don't have this unique spot. We can tell differences between different dogs, different packs, by just using the body markings. It doesn't have to be white, it can be a brown spot. It doesn't have to be brown, it can be a black spot as well.
I saw toucan.
Right.
So is that the dog?
No, toucan is a pack. And when you check on that board, we have different packs that we've had over the past 2 years. That toucan was a resident of Impala, had stayed at Impala for an extended period of time. All these packs have been followed by the project, and every pack has had a collared individual. But you know what? Right now, as we're talking, we don't have any individual from all these packs. They're all dead. What happened is that it was a little bit dry, and it was getting dry over time in Laikipia. And most of the communities, pastoral communities, were starting to move from northern parts of Kenya and streaming down towards Laikipia. And there's a very close association, by the way, between cattle, cows, goats, and sheep with domestic dogs. Something keen to notice is that domestic dogs are key reservoirs to benign diseases such as rabies, distemper virus. The domestic dogs created canine distemper outbreak. That thing killed all these packs within a span of 2 months.
So there are no more dogs left?
We had no more dogs. I was sitting in the office, no idea what to do. My boss was calling me, we should start packing up and leave. I mean, we are a wild dog project, but we have no dogs to follow. So what do?
Dedan was studying wild dogs for years, but in the span of just 2 months, they all disappeared.
But one day, I heard this rare beep from a dog. Beep, beep, when I was looking for dogs at Impala. Amazingly, there's a single individual, a female adult, who had survived this outbreak. We didn't know how that had happened. We could not tell if it was natural immunity, but she used to be in a pack of 16. All the other 15 individuals died, but she remained. She was roaming all over Impala, going around, hunting by herself, and she survived by herself for close to 2 months. Within a few couple of days after that, two males from nowhere just came down and caught up with her. And now we had 3 dogs all over Laikipia. And what happened, which is even more interesting, within a couple of months, like 2-3 months, she started denning. She was just about to give us puppies. Within some time, we had 8 puppies. So we are talking about rising from ashes, from a single dog to a total of 11 dogs within less than a period of 1 year.
So a new pack?
Not a new pack. The only pack in Laikipia.
What's the name of this pack?
It's called Phoenix Park. It's the savior park. We are moving. We are talking of packing. Let's pack. Let's go. We've nothing to do here. Then a single beep saved us.
That's amazing. And from that single beep, Dedan's work with these wild dogs would take an amazing turn. But first, he had to find the one surviving female. The Impala Ranch is home to many different species of animals, but one reason why it is special is because it has the last remaining pack of wild dogs in all of Laikipia. Finding them is almost impossible. The best way is to follow the alpha female, but finding her is a huge task. That doesn't seem to faze Dedan.
This is very exciting.
Right.
Dedan, thank you so much giving us your day.
No problem.
Okay.
I was working with a guy called Adam Ferguson.
Uh-huh.
That's when I was taking my master's.
Yeah.
And then I started my own master's project on domestic dogs like 4 years ago.
Right.
All the way from 2010, wild dogs used to be my favorite species. Because I learned about their social organization, how well socially they are organized, their hunting skills and everything. And now I've been doing that for over 2 years, I think.
Fantastic.
But I've also been running the rabies vaccination campaigns and and working on dogs as well.
These are the reticulated giraffe. It's different from the ones we have in Nairobi. See how the stripes, the patterns are totally different. This is one of the tallest of all the giraffe species in the world.
So what I do, the first trick about tracking dogs is, the first thing is just make sure you go to a higher place, because what you say is that get the first beep, or rather signal. Beep is when the caller communicates with the antenna I have.
Right.
So get the first beep and then follow that direction. So there's nothing much you can do without a beep. So you see, when I stop over here, this is usually my stopping place.
Okay.
You can see all below north, you see?
Oh, I see?
It's so high up. I mean, it's not as much higher, but when you stop on top of the car, you'll be seeing everywhere. So last night, I left the dogs close to that glade. You see that glade down there? They were just around there. So hopefully they've not moved much and we can get a signal from here.
The first challenge is to find her. And if anyone can do it, it's Dedan. He knows her patterns of behavior better than anyone.
Just help me with the antenna, please.
If her collar dies, we may lose her. Timing is everything.
Okay. So right now I have three collars, but 2 collars are not working. Those are the collars we need to retrieve today and replace with new collars. But 1 collar is working so well. This is a receiver and this is an antenna. So the receiver communicates with the collar, and then when there's communication, it produces a beeping sound, and you'll definitely hear that.
Once we find her, she'll have to be tranquilized. We have to be close enough for the dart to reach her shoulder or thigh. Then her collar can be changed.
Hopefully we can see them as they hunt, but the best time we'll have to see them now, if we miss them, is when they sleep. Because now we'll be sure they are. But they're definitely in this direction.
Well, let's go then.
Yeah, let's go this way.
You can see something down there, but there might be compelling.
You don't want to drive a long distance without following the signal. So I usually ensure that I get
impalas.
Deren's enthusiasm for his work and these dogs is remarkable. He's remained committed, even as he witnessed all the packs die out.
You are a wild man in Africa.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Oh, awesome. We found the pack of wild dogs. There are about six young dogs. They're all playing and interacting with each other, but they're actually hunting. Last night they only got a small prey, so they're hungry. They're out hunting, they're running. They are a phenomenal species. They can run so fast and they can disappear instantly. So we'll see them and then suddenly they're gone. So the wild dogs have come deep into the bush. They might have caught something. We did hear some noise. Oh, they've killed a prey. They've killed something, apparently, deep in the bush. So we're just going to try and get a bit closer so we can see them. There's a hyena. There's a hyena following them. This is very typical of what happens with wild dogs. They're such efficient killers that other predators that are more like scavengers, like hyenas, will actually follow behind them in order to get some of their food off them. Oh yes, I can see it over there.
Deren needs to change her collar and record her health and condition. The survival of wild dogs depends on the pack because they coordinate their hunts and share their kills, even helping sick individuals, which is why it is so surprising that she survived alone for so long. She must have hunted small antelopes, rodents and birds, and roamed across hundreds of kilometers in search of mates.
The most amazing thing about wild dogs is that, unlike many other species, in a wild dog pack, we have two alphas, an alpha female and an alpha male. Don't mistake and think that the alphas are meant to be decision makers in the group. They are not necessarily the decision makers. Listen, they can be the decision makers, but they are not necessarily the decision makers. So it's not them who really determine where we should go hunting, where we should stay, what we should do. They have a unanimous way of making decisions when all together. The alpha male and the alpha female are the only breeding pair in the pack. Nobody else can breed.
The survival of these dogs is of critical importance, and that is why Dr. Mutinda from the Kenya Wildlife Service has come to help. Uh-huh. At last, we find our alpha female.
The project has a goal of putting at least two collars in a pack, the VHF collar and a GPS collar. A VHF collar just gives you a random direction of where the dogs are. A GPS collar can give you location data, where basically you can be able to visualize on your computer on how the dogs have been moving. Putting two collars, at least in a single pack, the project has managed to put out over 160 collars at the moment.
You're good, leader.
Is that how that collar looked when you started?
Yes. This collar is 3 years old.
She needs oxygen throughout the process because she's so precious to both the pack and to Dedan. As the alpha female, she is the only one who can breed in this entire landscape. Everything possible must be done to help her stay alive. There's a reason why taking the data from this female is so important. She alone somehow survived the distemper outbreak. She may have a natural immunity, so whatever data we can get from her is vital in understanding why she lived.
Yes, yes.
The radio collar is just being put on this female. She's been down for about 25 minutes now. We only have about 10 more minutes to go. She's doing fine, but it is a hot day, so we need to keep her cool. We need to speed it up. She's had some blood taken, so the blood will be taken to the labs. Some other samples, her body health generally is being checked, and she's getting a little bit of extra oxygen, just in case. Dr. Matinda and Dedan are making sure that the collar is exactly the right size. Too big and it will fall off, too small and it could be too tight around her neck, which would make her have difficulty in feeding. So it's quite precise. You have to check and counter-check, and they've agreed on the size of the collar now that they're putting on.
It's a very hot day, so Dedan cools her down with water. Now all we need to do is give her some space and wait for her to wake up. Her pack is not far away, but there are hyenas and lions in this area. They wouldn't hesitate to kill her in this vulnerable state. One of the main threats to wild dogs is people. The community that live near our pack in Laikipia keep livestock, and to them, the wild dogs are a threat to their livelihood. Dedan knows that in order to change people's attitudes, he has to convince them to help protect the dogs.
I wonder if Dedan, if you could ask these wazirs, these old men, if there are any animals that give them any problems in this area, any wild animals.
Mzee, sasa, mbwa zikikuja hapa, zikuja ziingie hapa kwa hii kijijini, watu watafanya nini?
Aya. Sisi tawa, kama anaingia hapa na kuja kukula mali, naweka supu kuki. Na usi kunyamasea pesa yangu kama mimi nachukua. Na mimi naweza kunyimilea.
This is a typical homestead out here just outside of the conservation area of Impala, and these people live together with all the wildlife and of course all their livestock. It's quite heartbreaking to see what life must be like for them. They've said that if the suyan, or the wild dog, comes into this corral for their goats and sheep, they could lose up to 20 animals in just 10 minutes. This is the kind of situation that puts not only human livelihoods at stake, but it also puts the wild dogs at risk. They said if wild dogs showed up here today, they would just kill them. And that's one of the reasons why wild dogs are in so much danger. So Dedan, what's it like being an ecologist studying these animals? every day.
I mean, the simplest expression to what I do is that it's amazing, exciting, and of course interesting. And what it is like is just getting up every day, because I'm so close to the dogs, and so on, to just find them every day, see what's happening, get the data, plot the data, see where they spent the whole night. So that's my work. It's a full-time job just for me. That's what I'm doing, because that's the only dogs we have around, but also trying to ensure that we can use that park to hopefully get our population kicking back again.
So every day you wake up, and what time do you start?
Mostly what I might start working depends on where I left the dogs, what I want to do with the dogs the following day. If I want to get some social data on the dogs before they start hunting, then that means I will have to get up like 5, go and visit the dogs around 6, 6:30, such that by the time they start socializing, they usually socialize before they go out. So every time before they start socializing, I am with them. Get some data, see how everything is, and then that's a day. If I'm only interested in downloading data from the collars, that means you can do it when they are running, hunting, and all those things. So wait till they're done hunting, 9, 10, go find them sleeping, get the data with ease, do observations, and I'm done.
What's your dream for the wild dogs? What do you hope to achieve?
What I would want to see in future is a population that is stable, and a population that can maintain itself without being affected by like forces outside. So right now, we are talking of a population of 10 wild dogs in Laikipia, which is amazing. So we are working towards seeing what we can do with those dogs, just protect them, like take care of them. I mean, there's no way we can take care of them, but we just want to observe them every day and see that they grow to be adults. Hopefully, one of the dogs gets to den again this year, we get more puppies, and the population will grow over time. So one thing is that we are confident, and we'll do all we can to ensure that the population is growing up again. And now, to do that, we don't need just science. We need to do some social stuff with community people, because these dogs are interacting with people every day. We need to conduct vaccination programs, rabies vaccination programs, canine distemper vaccination programs. So it's a combination of different aspects. And that's what I'm sure the project and me, we are interested in doing together to see a growing population. And we'll be so excited to have many Kenyans and anybody else come volunteer in our project, learn at the same time, help give a few services, follow the dogs, and
so
also work with
us. People could come and help you to actually track the dogs and record all that data.
100%,
the way that everyone's helping you.
We would be so excited to host them, to have them around, just work with us, get the experience. I mean, not just on air, but get it live, like get to see the dogs and also track them and see all the kind of stuff we do with the dogs.
How do you feel at the end of the day? You've spent the day with the dogs, you've been sitting with them, watching them, listening to them.
Right.
How do you feel?
I mean, I've had this experience for over the 2 years I've been working on dogs, but I guess the most exciting thing about this is that I'm working with a different team that I've never had before. And again, I've got an opportunity to give the word, to spread the word, say what the project is working, get to have people come and learn what we do. So of course, tracking the dogs, finding them, spending hours with them is an experience, something that I always relish and I always like and interesting, but having people visit, see what we're doing, stay with me for some time, learn, that's the most exciting part of this thing. And I'm so excited, and I'm definitely looking forward to have such more experiences.
Deren's hard work has paid off. He called me 9 months after we had filmed with him and told me that our alpha female had given birth to 9 pups. This pack is growing, and it will eventually give rise to another pack and in time repopulate the entire region. It's just the beginning, but we now have new hope for the survival of this species.
Laikipia has had one of the largest populations of wild dogs in the whole world. But right now we are talking of a population that has been wildly reduced because of a disease outbreak. We have so many reasons to protect them. We need our kids to see these dogs 10 years after today. Their population is going down. It's not about tourism, but mostly it's a national heritage. People own them. We know it's our species. And when they get to near extinction, we feel terrible about that. So why we are protecting them is because we want the population to improve. We want the population to grow. We want 50 years after today, we want the dogs to be there. We want people to be doing research on the same dogs. We want students to be coming to Laikipia to see the dogs. And of course, some years after today, we still want Laikipia to be one of the best habitats for wild dogs conservation.
If you want to help our amazing wildlife, why don't you start a Wildlife Warriors Club in your school? To learn more about this program, please visit our website,